guys. This is Jane, and I am recording a YouTube video and doing the dishes. To a lot of people, this is going to look like a real copycat move, right? Well, it is. It totally is. But you know what? A good idea is a good idea. So, anyway, there's so much on my mind right now. I don't know how I'm going to get it all out there. It's like, wow. But, you know, that's kind of a cool place to be in, because I know that if this video comes out well, that was totally God working and not me, because my brain is all over the place. Now, what I really wanted to share is some stuff I've been learning lately about, it started with realization or revelation, whatever you want to call it, about communion. And I've been lately doing a lot of making connections between the Old Testament and the New Testament, and like trying to really get into the culture and understand God for who He was, is, you know, throughout all of history. Because I grew up in a kind of realm of thought where I guess the general consensus was we're going to focus on the New Testament because that's where Jesus was and that's where all the important stuff happened and blah, 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 blah. But a while back, I had determined, you know, I wanted to read all about Jesus, right? And so I started in Matthew and the Holy Spirit, like, tapped on my shoulder and said, excuse me. I'm like, huh? And he's like, the story of Jesus doesn't start in Matthew. It starts in Genesis. So, I'm like, oh, right. So, that's the story of why I've been kind of digging more into the Old Testament. And dude, that has been awesome. There is so much going on in Psalms. Like, if you read it just as a book of poetry, you're missing so much. There's warfare in there. There's, oh man, it's so cool once the Holy Spirit opens your eyes to what all is going on in the Psalms. But where am I? Okay. What hit me about communion in my quest to bring the God of the Old Testament and the God of the New Testament together was in Luke 22:11, which says, and he took bread, gave thanks, and broke it, and he gave it to them, saying, this is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. And you know, I've read that hundreds of times. I read that hundreds of times. I grew up in church. I know, you know, I'm pretty good with the Bible. But that had never struck me before the way it did a little while ago. Because I realized that what Jesus was saying there was something he had been saying throughout the entire Old Testament. Dozens of times God says, remember me. Remember how I brought you out of Egypt. Remember my covenant with you. Remember my laws for you. He's always, always talking like that. Remember me. Don't forget me. Don't forget what I've done. And, man, that really got me. Jesus is saying the same thing. I've been learning more about communion too, and the new covenant, and the way sealing a covenant with blood would have been a familiar concept for the disciples, but Jesus took it a whole new direction, right? There's so much more to communion. There's so much more to symbols than I knew before. Let's just go with communion and baptism too. You know, the grape juice or wine, I mean, it's just grape juice or wine, and bread is just bread. They're symbols, okay? The water in baptism is just H2O, right? But symbols, when combined with the power of the Holy Spirit, accomplish something bigger. You go get baptized for the wrong reasons, you're just getting wet. But if you get baptized by somebody who knows God and has the Holy Spirit alive and at work in them, then something really happens on a spiritual level. And that is so over my head still. It just amazes me the stuff God does. But yeah, those symbols are more important and more powerful than I realized before. So with the Holy Spirit at work in the process, the act of communion, the taking the bread and the wine, which you don't have to do at church, by the way, which is something I learned, 6 months ago. I had never taken communion at home before. I mean, who does that? It was a weird, foreign thing to me. Like, I almost thought that in order to take communion, you had to be at church. But, you don't. And taking communion in private, like just you and Jesus, is so amazing. It brings a whole new level of intimacy, which is, I'm learning more and more, it's what God's looking for. It's what Jesus died for, was that intimacy with us. And it just blows my mind that he wants that. You know, the way we think of ourselves is so limited, you know? I look in the mirror and I see a pretty average girl, right? But Jesus sees me completely differently because of the way he loves. Isaiah 53:11 says, well, it's when Isaiah is describing the suffering servant, and it's one of the most descriptive prophetic accounts in the Old Testament of what the Messiah is going to go through. He writes, when he sees all that is accomplished by his anguish, he will be satisfied. And what did he accomplish by his anguish? He made a way for a relationship with me and with you. That is what satisfies Jesus. That's how much he wants us to be near us, to have that relationship. When I was in high school, I went on this spiritual retreat camp thing, right, with a whole bunch of other high school students, and it's called Faith Quest, and it was really good. I went on Faith Quest 12, and now they're on like 33, so it was a while back. But because of one thing, one evening at Faith Quest, I felt God speak to me, and I finally let myself believe what people tend to say, you know. They say that if you were the only person in the world, then Jesus still would have died for you. And I never believed that. Never did. I'm like, yeah, sure. And I would smile and I would say, yeah, I love Jesus, this, that, and the other thing, and put on the face, but deep down, I never believed it. And I still go through moments where I don't. Like, why in the world would anybody love me that much? You know? It doesn't make sense. And, you know, that's part of God. His ways are above our ways, and he's just not gonna make sense completely. But in that moment, I remember, as I was crying and I was laughing and I was praying, Jesus, if I was the only person, you still would have died. It's ridiculous, and it's not logical, and it's amazing, and it's wonderful, and it's beautiful, and it blows my mind all the time. Big guns. Ha! But to grasp that love takes commitment, takes quiet time with God. There's so much that God wants to give us that we don't get because we're too busy doing other stuff, chasing after human relationships, money, popularity, fame, stuff, knowledge. We chase after so much. And God looks down and sees us running around. He's like, stop. Stop. Running around looking for all these things to find fulfillment. And He's just waiting. Wants to give us so much, and we miss it because we're busy and we're distracted and we're bombarded. But every morning it's the same. Every morning we wake up and He's still there. He's still available. He's still waiting. He's still watching. His heart is so full of love for us. It's completely beyond our comprehension. And when we don't return that love, when we get all wrapped up in other things and we don't even try to spend time with Him, it would make me mad. It would make me so mad. Be like, really? Are you serious? I'm gonna go through all this to make a way for us, and you think that's more important? I would be so ticked off. I don't know if He gets that way sometimes. But I do know He never stops loving. The Bible says His mercies are new every morning. That's such a good thing because I need them pretty much every morning. I am so not perfect. I mess up all the time. In fact, I just came out of a really big period of distraction and kind of wandering around aimlessly, trying to go after spiritual stuff mostly. But when you seek God for what you want from Him, instead of just seeking Him because He is, and He's yours, and you're His, and you seek God selfishly. You're only in it for spiritual gifts, the help with your circumstances. He's not as into it as when you're just seeking Him for Him. When you're just longing to be near Him. Just, David wrote, I will wait all night long just to feel your presence.
where I want to be at.
We can't comprehend God, but we can know Him based on what He has chosen to reveal to us. Does that make sense? On our own, we are completely hopeless. The only way to know God is to know God on His terms. Because all this stuff that man makes up, it's nonsense. Nonsense. Rituals and this, that, and the other thing that people came up with, it's not going to get you anywhere. We get to know God by taking advantage of what He has provided for us to get to know. And one big way He's revealed Himself to us is through the names that He gave us to call Him by. You know? And they're cool. Like, each one means different things, and He gave different names to different people based on how He wanted them to see Him. You know, as a provider, as an all-powerful creator, that sort of thing. My favorite name that I've studied so far is Adonai. It's translated the Lord. In English Bibles, the Hebrew word Adonai, they write the Lord. But a more literal translation would be my Lord's. Because the word there is actually both possessive and plural, which is very cool because the plural points to the Trinity, right? Father, Son, Holy Spirit, three in one, one God, right? And I just love the possessive nature of the word, because God does not have any obligation to be my anything. I mean, he's so up there and out there and holy and he's so beyond me. Why would he want to be my anything? But he called himself Adonai. So he wants to be my Lord. That's what's on my mind. And hopefully it made some sense to somebody. I love you guys. Bye.